We'll just have to see how long this dungeon is. If there's a lot left to go, that'll be one thing. This looks like Sun and Shadow. Okay, so yeah, we're here. Given that we're here already, this is probably the end game.
Ready to take the oath, to spread the word of the gods to the lost and heathen.
Ring of Unshackled.
I am trusting you to remain loyal to the gods in this. If you do not, you will have greater powers than me to answer to. But you will answer to me as well. I wouldn't ask this were there any other choice.
This is a missionary, same as I was. Taught the wrong things as I was. Asionis. They have held off many would-be invaders.
You are ready to give a confession?
I am ready to hear one from you.
Okay, so we are ready to move on. How weird would it be if you played this game as like a cleric or something? That is a lot of experience. Too bad I can't use any of it. You've come to a circular room, grand and domed, its walls lined with Adra and trimmed with copper. At the far end of a great pillar of Adra pierces the floor from below like a ragged spike, its shimmering texture giving the illusion of boundless depth. Your thoughts are yours and not yours, and they are all questions. At the base of the pillar stands Theos, a look of concern on his face as he notes your approach. You have something you want to ask him, one question above all others, spinning madly in your mind, but you don't dare ask it yet. You need some admission from him first, some hint of the veracity of your suspicions.
You are far from your post, Inquisitor. What brings you here? It has many uses, but its purpose is to bring structure to the chaos that surrounds it. They are monuments to Whitaker's greatest servants among my people. I hope to join them myself one day, but my work is not yet complete. That woman sought only to destroy the foundations of peace and civility that my people sacrificed everything to build. The Inquisition was based on the need to cut the flesh from a rotting wound. We are in a sanctum holy to Utica. There are others like it in service to the other gods. I come here often to pray for her counsel, and in this space I may be assured that she hears me.
You're shaking now, having lost all patience for tact. No more evasions. You have to know everything you believed, everything you've done to the gods. Did you lie to me when you said the gods would absolve my sins?
What is a god? A higher power? A rewarder of good deeds and punisher of the wicked? Something men can turn to in their darkest moments when their days seem only like bridges from one tragedy to the next? Our gods are all these things. We're in a sacred place within earshot of the gods themselves. This is not the time. You've been through much these past few months. You will return home and you will rest. When you feel you have recovered, you may rejoin us at the trials. The Inquisition is far from over, and I will have need of you. There are many who continue to spread the lies of the apostate. The Inquisition will not end until we have pronounced judgment on all of them.
His eyes linger on you, and there is no mistaking the threat behind it. Your rage shrinks at the image of an iron wheel in your mind, monolithic and caked with dried blood of thousands. You do not ask your question again.
How did you find it? Another in a string of acts of petty defiance. For all her knowledge, she always preferred spite over reason.
This was from a long time ago. I'm gonna go with number one, I guess.
Then she should have obeyed. I ask one thing of all my followers. She was incapable. A waste of rare talent and intellect. What of your cohorts, then? They have followed you to their deaths. Is it loyalty that brings them here? Or is it, as my agents suggest, that they have no direction of their own? You worshipped Aethys, did you not?
Your spies are good. What gave me away? The cape?
Yet when your god needed you the most, you chose your country.
We were being invaded. Not by anyone who was acting like a god.
Then I should think your hometown gave you a hero's welcome when you returned.
They made cake. Hard to blame people for losing faith when it's the gods who are misbehaving.
The gods argue over how best to prevent Kith society from destroying itself. These disruptions would not be necessary were mortal instinct not so diseased.
Interesting.
You built a weapon that delivered exactly as promised.
I served my goddess as you did yours.
Yet the other builders were slain. 11 of a dozen. Why not you? Were you somehow different? Redeemable in your god's sight?
There was a message there, whether she meant it or not.
Or was it merely that your goddess wanted you dead as well? And your delusions of importance prevented you from seeing the obvious.
A whore's beguiling charms, nothing more. But the spell's broke now, Theos. The trial's over. I know friend from foe. And I've come here now to see a foe repaid.
You were able to destroy a god because another god wished it. Without her hand to guide you, you could not strike at a god any more than you could strike the sky. You are impotent, and not just from the pox. I understand your Duke's bells gave you a mission.
Their orders did not absolve me of my greater responsibility to the safety and well-being of the Republics. Might want to skip over this one fast. Don't want to pick a fight you can't win.
Yet you disobeyed. Something you already have a reputation for. They will know, of course. If it had been for a worthy cause, they might have forgiven you. But I don't see them pursuing animancy after seeing what it's done here. They trusted you, and you disappointed, as you always have. And you will again be disowned.
The parents scold, but the children are safe. Whether animancy research continues in Republics or not, they will survive. For now, that's enough. In any case, I wouldn't be so smug about my fate, Theos. I imagine Wotica responds to disappointment much more severely than even my dukes.
State your name and purpose, young acolyte.
My name belonged to the gods and my hand to their service. No more.
You serve none but yourself. Without contact with your order, you can have no higher purpose. Only the base concerns of the flesh. You have cast yourself from our ranks.
And I should have done it years before. I'd rather live in uncertainty than servitude.
And that uncertainty would lead you where it leads everyone. To doubt, to emptiness, to the many cruelties inspired by disbelief. You will have to forgive your Grandmaster for remaining skeptical of his initiate's choices. You are here because you are lost. The gods cannot reach everyone, I'm afraid. May you fare better in your next lives. I gather you have had your soul awakened. Why else would you shadow my footsteps like some stray mongrel? You think I have something to offer you, but our business was concluded long ago.
Can you go on the report?
I answered your questions once. That your soul is not fit to accept the answers is of little concern to me. I lied to no one. Not to you, not to anyone. The gods are real. They are everything we need them to be, and the world is better for it.
I'm gonna go with number 4.
Guilt is a disease of the mind. If the mind no longer believes it is guilty, then that is as good as absolution. The heart of this country has skipped a beat. Nothing more. I have done far worse. I plunged the peaceful kingdom of Telosus into civil war. I slew the monarch of Desantio, whose people never knew hardship under his rule, and replaced him with a cruel despot who brought them to ruin. When plague arrived at the great city of Arborensis, I saw to it that the cure did not. They piled their dead outside the city in heaps that rose above their walls.
You're number 1.
That's where you are mistaken. There was a time, back when your soul was still a shapeless mist, when the world believed only in false gods. Thousands of them. Gods that told them to take slaves. Gods that told them to make war upon their neighbors and devour the slain. Gods that told them to burn their children alive and cover themselves in the ashes as a sign of their faith. But all that changed when they learned of the true gods. Our gods. All those misshapen, bestial instincts melted beneath the radiance of our god's majesty. You could see it in their eyes. That dull emptiness replaced with the glimmer of a kindled spark.
Rule number 1.
And replaced it with one far worse. Have you imagined this existence? The one the apostate would have created. We are not all so virtuous as she. Without our gods, the most wicked, the most tyrannical, they would take that power for themselves. But more than that, it would be a hollow existence. All mysteries forever unanswered. All purposes constructed from meaninglessness. No endings to bring closure. Only a wheel turning without mercy. Grinding our spirits to dust.
That kind of seems like what he has created as opposed to what they would have otherwise. All mysteries forever and unanswered because everyone thinks they already have the answers. Purposes constructed from meaninglessness. I mean, they have gods that are supposed to grant the meaning, except those gods are constructs, right? There's no ending because the souls are continuously being cycled through and they're being controlled by these constructed deities. I'm gonna go with
because he's just talking bullshit.
For all my years, I have seen exactly what they are capable of. What the apostate asked was beyond any man. All I have seen, the millennia of experience. I will not be dissuaded from this course. This is the only way.
I'm gonna go with number three.
We are all controlled by our own doubts. Better that we should be relieved of them. With your soul and thousands of others, I will see this world purged of its suffering. Hear me, Woodica. Your servant calls for aid.
Well, something's happening.
Roach 10!
Oh, so we will have to deal with those. Oh, we failed the Trials of Durance. Why? I guess presumably because we just entered the endgame. Let's see. We have Wodica's judge and the headsman. I think it's best to get him here. He's going after Aldrea. I think I want Aldrea to back up and have stuff. I'm actually going to send these people here. Okay, so first things first, get Aldrea where she needs to go. I'm going to send Palagina in here. We're going to try to knock him over. So, it's possible that what I should have done was actually sent in, let's try disintegration. I don't want to use my petrification move yet, because I kind of feel like this is, might be a multi-phase fight. So let's see about this. So he is a cleric. He's got Holy Radiance active. So he's casting Fountain of Faith. I'm gonna cast Sparks of the Soul of Righteous, whatever this thing is. And I'm gonna try to get a fly.
Quit!
So Thaos is injured. He's got Disintegrate on him. That's good. So he just jumped out of his own body and into Theos's, into Wodica's judge. So I think his current body, his normal body, can't be injured right now, and that's fine.
Yeah.
That's perfectly fine. So what we can do now is go after Wodica's judge, and now we know how this fight operates. And let's see if we can knock these guys over. No, not terribly likely, but it's possible. So, that was a mess. And a boatload of damage that we just did. Wow, these guys have a lot of buffs. Try to use restore character endurance. And turned. I'm actually going to try to parallel. Petrified the top one. It is petrified for 6 seconds. Unfortunately, I just noticed you're prone for a lot longer than that. I didn't notice that he had already gone this way. So first heal has gone out. So we got Shields of the Faithful up. Let's put Bless up. Let's bring him. Let's try to.
Arthek were Sunra!
Did we not get him? We are looking at some very high. Should I heal?
Arthek were Sun.
These guys are using some very unpleasant again. I'm gonna try to do this. I don't think it's gonna work, but I mean it's worth an attempt at any rate. Gonna have him pop the fence. I'm gonna try to not. So what is hurting? Shiny spell that he was just casting. Fortunately, Aldrea is not in a very good position right now. She's getting hit by the AoEs that are going on the other guy. So we are gonna have to reload here. On the plus side, we do now have a demonstration of how the fight operates. Ten. Okay, so boys on our back as we can. Dead center. Perfect. Perfect. That's exactly where we want this guy. So he's gonna attack. He's gonna need all the defense he can get. And we're gonna go ahead and start up the petrified. So that's useful. Unfortunately, it's not as useful as it could be because it's such a short petrification effect. And because this guy's charging it. So let's not send in the melees, but we will try to burst out some good damage here while he's got the effect on. this pillar down here. I think that that might tag him on the side. Let's get a disintegration on this guy, because that should do an obscene amount of damage. It won't. I don't think it'll have any bonus damage. No, come on, man. So, she's down. She didn't get her disintegrate off. Let's try to petrify this guy. Leos is petrified for 12 seconds. And we're just gonna try to burst as much damage into it as humanly possible. Okay, Aldrea should be able to kill him. So Aldrea just killed Leos.
Forgive me.
Okay. So the scariest damage dealer is dealt with. We still have these two to deal with, but we can hopefully deal with them.
Ludica. Someone fell the...
Okay, so what we need now is a way of... Are you gonna die? He's gonna die. He's in the Shining Beacon, but that's okay because he should come back. Either way, we're gonna use Revive and Fall on.
Feisty.
Okay, so that brings both of them back up. She should be able to come back here. We can try to get a disintegration off on this.
I'm ready.
Did we get it off? So we're gonna pull back, because that guy's casting bad things. Okay. So we were able to burst down Theos. And we've got quite a lot of spells at our disposal still. I'm gonna cast this on everybody.
Hi.
Okay. I'm gonna get a Malignant Cloud up. And let's try to get a wall fire as well. Okay, so let's cast a minor intercession. Whoa, what is that, 21? Ooh, that Malignant Cloud, very nice. So I definitely don't want to cast anything from that spell set. So the fireball is actually hitting for good damage. And these guys are burning, baby. It's not perfect, but this guy, we might actually, well, no, if we pull him back, we run into the issue. What I could do, I don't know if it'll work, and if it doesn't, then I'll be killing myself. That would be then I'd get laughed at. So, I'm gonna use the better malignant power for this building. Okay, so this guy's near death. Let's see how. Yeah, so there's a pretty substantial chance to miss here. But there's also a pretty substantial chance to miss. So he's out of that level. I think it might be my best interest to just cast one. Oh, I can hit it with it. Did a lot, but and it probably did enough to justify. Son of a bitch, it just crit him? He's gonna die from that, I think. So that's not good. That is very not good. That's dangerous. It is pretty close to there. Okay, so that one's dead actually. We've got just Lodica's Judge left. All we have to do is get the thing that's already near death here all the way to dead. And there we go. At your feet rests the body of Theos, hollow, the dense wrinkles shaped by the silent shouldering of an eternal burden now smoothed across his color-drained face. His soul remains still for the moment, defenseless, its energy expended in defeat. It lies sprawled across his body like a death shroud.
Thousands of souls he has tortured. Would that he could live those sufferings a thousand times himself.
In his own way, Theos must have truly believed he was caring for the people of Aeora, protecting them from themselves. A shame his soul won't have a chance to reflect on his errors before it enters the wheel.
At some point, you have to look at the things your god is telling you to do. Ask yourself if it's worth it.
He spent his lives, more than any of us will ever know. For what? Binding the world to a lie. Could a man like that ever be redeemed?
With a deep breath, you plunge into Theos' soul, and where in Brackenbury it had been a maze of narrow corridors and dead ends, now it is expansive and borderless, its walls crumbling into heaps like the ruins of Angwith as you pass through them. You travel for what seems like ages, rushing to a known destination, a memory you glimpsed once before. At last you see it, no more than a pinprick of light at the end of a long tunnel, expanding slowly at first, then quickly as you near. You come out in the room you're standing in now, but it is new and pristine and filled with people, thousands of them, all turned toward the great Audra pillar and the machine that encases it. Theos stands at the machine, and you are one with him now. You look out at the crowd, to faces of shriveled old men and cherub-cheeked little girls, as mothers bouncing infants to quiet them, and fathers clasping their children's restless hands and watching you with somber acceptance. A woman with tears in her eyes gives you a small nod. You turn back toward the machine, your breaths constricted beneath the weight of unwanted knowledge, preparing yourself to set out alone on a journey without end. You close your eyes and open them again to find this machine still in front of you beckoning. You take your place in front of it and place your hand upon a large mechanical disc at the base of the great crystal column and speak a single word. Giant rings creak to life, building speed, setting arrays of carved draconic mouths aglow and sending tremors through the platform beneath you. The entire room shakes now with the force of the accelerating machine, all sound drowned out by its deep, deafening thrum. Brilliant tendrils of light arc outward from the pillar in all directions, and you look over your shoulder to see them engulfing the crowd, burning them brightly like hot iron. One by one, the tendrils disappear, leaving ashen effigies where people once stood, many of them disintegrating into gray heaps under the stress of the tremors. You look above the Audra pillar, and its glowing spherical mass had begun to coalesce atop the column where the arcs converge. It grows in pulses, translucent and bulbous like some immense chrysalis, suspended in slow rotation as though it were being spun by arcs from the arcs of light. When the last arc disappears, the spectral mass hangs on a moment, no longer rotating. So bright, you must shield your eyes with an outstretched hand. It seems as though it is looking at you. You bow your head in acknowledgement and look back up to see it melt into the pillar like warm candle wax. The pillar flares with a flash of light, bright as the sun itself, then fades to darkness. The machine slows to an abrupt halt, and when the last echo of its grinding cogs has passed, the chamber is still and you are alone. From all sides, reality begins to bleed in through the memory, and you find yourself in your own skin once more, looking down at Theos' lifeless body. You sense a listlessness in Theos' soul, an overwhelming fatigue that hinders its immediate escape and makes it vulnerable to manipulation. You feel as though your victory has given you some kind of hold over it, and you are able to do with it as you please. I think I'm going to return it to the cycle. I think I'm going to go with number one, because he's not, we have just basically beaten him, and by beating him we prove that he's not a threat to Eldraea. He might be a threat to other people, but I think that I'm going to go with number one.
You've let him off too easily, Watcher. I would have left such scars on his soul that he'd have begged escape from the wheel's turn.
Some acts can't be forgiven.
A cruelty worthy of this man. Let him know the pain he has wrought. Let his own choices be his punishment.
I suppose we'll see if he can rise above that.
You can feel the pull of the intricate Adra capillaries that rise up from the depths below the chamber. Many are bound up in the Great Pillar and would pass to Wotica, but some are filled with the souls of the dead, bound for somewhere else entirely, and you know that these are the paths of rebirth. Stretching your presence as far as your spirit can allow, you make contact with one such path, and between it and yourself, you open up what feels to be a long tunnel, sheer and undulating through the gullet of some enormous beast. You shift your focus to Theos' soul, clinging weakly to its vanquished shell, and with all your concentration, you wrench it free and send it hurtling through the channel until it passes into the Adra vein and can be felt no more. In the stillness that follows, a single word echoes in your mind, a word you spoke when you were one with Theos in the ancient memory. You realize it is the word that activates the machine.
This thing isn't doing the job.
So everybody has something they want to say to me. They're probably going to try to tell me what I should do. Hmm? So let's talk to them.
Ah, the end of the road greets us at last. You fared well, Watcher. Better than any Watcher has right to. Seems you were afield in need of a flame's cleansing. But with that trial's end, a new one begins. A God's trial. And I will stand in judgment without mercy.
Hey. Theos, He had hold of your soul from a long time back, seems like. You get what you needed from him?
I guess I got an answer to an old question.
Those can be hard to come by. But maybe that's best. Forces you to find your own footing. You'll be feeling better soon, then. Good. That's real good. You got it figured out what you're going to do about all that?
Maybe.
Got a lot of people out there thinking they've been abandoned by their gods. There's not much that'll put the fear in you more than that. You can take my word for it. If it was in my power, and I know it's not, but if it was, I'd find a way to give them the courage to face it. Not because they think there's some god looking out for them, but because they've just got it in them. And after what you've been through, though, I'm sure you got your own ideas. Better make it good.
He has basically the right idea. That's basically the sentiment.
So much for Theos, then. Now you have a chance to set things right, back to the proper order of things. It will take the Deerwood generations to recover. But at least these souls will find their way back to the wheel, as it should be.
Aye?
Astounding. I always knew the Leaden Key stood for something big, but I didn't quite realize what I'd gotten myself into. And now, you're in the middle of something even bigger. The decision that will affect millions. But even if you send the souls somewhere specific now, who knows what the next turn of the wheel will make of them? We can't really control what happens to them. Nor should we try. I had to see the monster Theos had become to realize that.
That's very accurate.
Your thoughts must flow deeply indeed.
Theos may be gone, but his crimes, the wounds he has inflicted, remain. Yet before you lies an opportunity to heal, to restore. Only through the healing of families, repairing the bonds between parent and child, reforging the shattered links between generations, can the Deerwood be knit whole once more.
That sounds reasonable.
People will long remember the legacy. Let them also remember the healing that followed.
Okay, so what we're gonna do now is go up here and see what our options are. I don't know how this machine works. I don't know what my options are. So we'll find out whether... I can do any cool stuff with it. With your companions bearing witness, you step up to the place where Theos once stood before his people long ago. The great machine lies in front of you, idle, ready. You've seen this machine and others like it in operation. You understand how it works. It is a device for directing soul. As a watcher, it would be a simple matter to influence that direction, though as big as the machine is, it's the last thing. It may be the last thing you ever do. Let's do it. There's a shrieking of stone, grinding against stone as old cogs loosen and begin to turn. You only have moments before the souls will be sent to the Audravane. This will be your only chance at redirecting them. So basically, the deities wanted me to distribute the essence to the existing souls to strength. I'm going to return the souls to the bodies that they were intended for, because that's... Like, sending them back to the reincarnation cycle seems like basically the same thing, only not quite as good. So I'm going to go with the return. And the deities are going to be really pissed at me. And then we can have a war against the gods, and that'll be awesome, so it'll be cool. So, you close your eyes and expand your perception outward, taking in the immense totality of the tens of thousands of souls orbiting the chamber. Your grasp on the souls is tenuous. You find yourself fighting to keep them all within your influence, and you can feel them slipping away as the machine gains speed. A brief moment comes when it feels as if you hold all of them at once, and their force is so great that it feels as though it will tear you apart. In that moment, you dedicate your entire being to bending their orbit, channeling their flow in a new direction. I didn't actually read what it did.
At your command, The ancient device became your instrument, spinning to life with deafening resonance and gathering up the swirling essence like thread on a great spindle. There, in the pale pulsing glow of the machine that set you on this path long ago, you summoned all your strength, focusing on your objective and blocking out all else. With a single concussive blast that rocked the chamber and sent you tumbling to the ground, you freed the souls from their stasis. Exhausted, your consciousness slipping away, your last sight was of the machine, dark and dormant. Then your eyes closed, and sleep welcomed you at long last. After coming to and searching for some time, you discovered the route Theos used to enter Sun and Shadow, and embarked on a long and arduous ascent back to the surface. You emerged in Terra Evron after days of tunneling through the rubble Theos had left behind, and when you stepped into the daylight, you were faced with a different Deerwood than the one you had left. At your direction, the souls diverted by Theos were guided back to the vessels originally meant for them. For the first time, parents of hollow-born children woke to the cries of their infants and looked into their eyes to see them staring back. People fell to their knees where they stood, thanking Helia or Mogryn or even Aethys for their forgiveness of whatever guilt they felt they bore. But for all the relief that had come to some parents, others only found new grief. For many thousands of Hollowborn had died during Wydwin's legacy, many by their parents' own hands. For those children, there would be no homecoming. Yet the last Hollow birth was in the past now, and those parents willing to risk trying for a new child were frequently rewarded, often with twins. Many felt they saw Helia's hand in it, and the year would be remembered as the year of Helia's splendor. It is said that Gallowayn is the enforcer of the guards, and is known to hunt down those who wrong them. To wrong Gallowayn, then, is truly to wake the beast, and the father of monsters took great umbrage at your broken promise to him. Along with Mogryn and Abaddon, Gallowayn embarked upon a more direct approach to claiming his quarry. In the months that followed, the frontier settlements of Deerwood were inexplicably attacked by packs of beasts and monsters, suddenly organized and unafraid to approach Kith on their own land. Many such villages were all but destroyed by the time troops could be dispatched from local garrisons. Those that weren't destroyed by the beasts of Gallowayn often found themselves at the mercy of the fires of Mogryn. A dry spell throughout Deerwood led to a rash of forest fires on a scale not seen since the War of Black Trees, and many settlements paid the price for their proximity to the wilderness. In the cities, meanwhile, dabblers and animancy who had placed souls into golems and other moving vessels soon found that their creations had risen up against them. Such constructs terrorized their surroundings, killing indiscriminately and often in great numbers before being subdued. Lord Radric's zeal had brought him back to life once, but it would not do so again. Radric's destruction at your hands spelled the end of his suffocating rule over Gilded Vale and the surrounding area. In his absence, the village prospered, becoming a popular destination for new settlers anxious to leave Defiance Bay after the riots. Without a nearby ruler, it also grew more wild, with many settlers moving on as soon as they'd arrived, turned off by lawlessness that was excessive even by Deerwooden standards. Nevertheless, despite the challenges of living there, Gilded Vale had survived, and would continue to survive for the foreseeable future. Following the assassinations of Duke Avar Wulfgren and Lady Webb, Defiance Bay was thrown into political upheaval. In the ensuing weeks, the streets had become the domain of looters and blackguards. Few dared to step outside their own doors alone or unarmed. But once the dozens had regrouped in the wake of the riots, they quickly put an end to the criminal activity. They patrolled the streets in droves and administered their brand of law on any perceived offenders. This was not the erratic justice of the mob, however. The dozens had taken to heart the strengths of their adversaries, the Knights of the Crucible, and emerged as a far more organized, disciplined force. With the waning strength of the other Defiance Bay powers, The leadership of the Dozens took the opportunity to establish its own group as the dominant peacekeeping force in the city. The Dozens would soon find themselves overwhelmed by the problems of a leaderless metropolis. But they found an uneasy new partner in the surviving forces of the Crucible Knights, who understood the city's infrastructure and were able to keep the worst of its problems under control. Though the machine atop Terra Noeneth had been disabled, it had not seen its last use. Heritage Hill was rebuilt, and no sooner had the first families moved in to resettle the district than members of the Leaden Key, acting under standing orders from their Grand Master, climbed the tower and reactivated the machine. The initiates slew a handful of the new settlers under cover of night, and watched as history repeated itself, the victims reanimating and devouring the survivors. After this second incident, the district would remain abandoned. The Duke's assassination at the apparent hands of an animancer had caused catastrophic rioting in the streets of Defiance Bay. But those who had escaped the melee in the palace hearings remembered the testimonies of the strange guest who had shown up that day and absolved animancy, implicating the Leaden Key instead. The rumor spread quickly, and soon the popular belief was that the assassin had been a Leaden Key spy. When the legacy had lifted, people came to see it not as a sign that the riots had been according to the gods' wishes, as Theos had hoped, but as a confirmation that animancy had never been the source of the problem in the first place. Deerwoodens instead convinced themselves that the riots had somehow purged Defiance Bay of Leaden Key spies, and that the end of Widewind's legacy was their well-deserved reward. The rage against animancers was quickly forgotten, and those who had survived were permitted to return to Brackenberry Sanitarium and rebuild it so they might resume their studies. The fortress of Cad Nua emerged as a bastion of security in the midst of an untamed land, becoming the envy of every thane and earl in Deerwood. Legend grew over time of its impregnability, and stories of formidable invaders easily scattered by the keep's defenses became popular around the hearths of Deerwoodenians. Likewise, it also became a beacon to travelers, merchants, and visiting dignitaries alike. Reputed as the finest fortress in all Deerwood, people would journey from near and distant lands alike to experience its fabled hospitality and grandeur. After the death of the Master below, a strange quiet fell over the endless paths of Ad Nua. The attacks on the fortress above ceased, Ad Nua's silent titan the closest remaining thing to a master in its musty, forgotten passages. Palagina had gone against the Duke's Bell's orders by inventing a new trade arrangement with the Anamenfath to accommodate the recovering Deerwooden market. With the Deerwood's people still weakened by Widewind's legacy, the Valian Republics easily pushed their would-be competitors out of the market. For her outrageous insubordination and audacity, Palagina was banished from the Republics. She traveled north in the Eastern Reach, avoiding Valian ports and entering the ranks of the kind wayfarers. Despite her bravery and dedication to those in her care, her strange appearance made her feel like an outsider wherever she went. Adair chose not to return home to Gilded Vale. Still most comfortable far from cities, he settled in Deerford, which, like many towns in the Deerwood, was beginning the slow process of rebuilding. Believing now that it was the obligation of Kith to be the leaders their gods had not, Adair was soon named mayor of the town, and under his guidance, Deerford soon began to prosper. He expelled the last of the Scanites from the area and drew new settlers with the offer of land, a trick he had learned from someone he otherwise preferred to forget. With each passing day, Deerford would come to more closely resemble the Gilded Vale of Adair's childhood, the one worthy of its name. When the dust settled in sun and shadow, Aloth looked upon the remains of Theos Ixarchanon, his former master. He saw where the Grand Master had gone wrong, and what would be required to undo the harm Theos had wrought. With a flick of his wrist, he burned Theos's robe, headdress, and every other symbol of the man's power. Never again, he vowed, should Kith live in fear and blind obedience to an authority they did not understand. Armed with the knowledge and courage he had gained on his journeys with the Watcher, he set out on the long and lonely task of dismantling the Leaden Key. With both their aims fulfilled, Kanarua bid the Watcher farewell and sailed back to his beloved Rawatai. There, he reported on his findings to the Lore College. Kana spoke of the Ingwithan people, describing both their vile experiments and their inspiring accomplishments. He spoke too of the destruction of the tablet by the Leaden Key, and the group's efforts to erase the Ingwithan legacy from the world. Both inspiration and cautionary tales, he said, could be found in the world beyond Rawatai's borders. Kana urged his people to continue to pursue knowledge abroad so that the lessons found there might benefit Tekoa. Kana's inability to prove his theory of Ingwithan influence diminished his academic standing, but his passion drew much interest from those less concerned with degrees. Kana swiftly became an influential figure in the move toward a more collaborative approach to expansion on the Northern Continent. In his personal life, he came to enjoy the reputation of an affable eccentric, willing to share grand and impossible secrets along with a drink and a song. With Theos defeated and the souls released from Sun and Shadow, healthy children were born once again in the Deerwood. The grieving mother sought a place where she might do penance for the birthing bell. She returned to Deerford, where, to the astonishment of the villagers, she delivered the first healthy child in over a decade. She remained there, and with each new birth, she saw a measure of hope restored to the Deerwood and a measure of grace for her own troubled past. Durance continued to blame Woodica for the atrocities of the Saints' War. Believing Magrin to have been a pawn in the machinations of the Queen that was, and feeling that Theos's expulsion had been a step towards reconciliation with his goddess, Durance tried for a time to reopen communication with her. When only silence came, he took it as a condemnation of his continued existence. Ultimately, he built a pyre and threw himself upon it, using his own shattered staff as kindling. In her four-month journey back to Nausithoc, Sagani found that the landscape she traveled had become strangely colorless, the food bland and unsatisfying. She watched the Deerwood, Air Glonfoth, the Valian Republics, and the lands beyond slide by with a dull sense of dread. She returned home to great celebration, yet the words of joy and congratulations rang hollow to her. Old beloved songs sounded toneless. The rituals of changing seasons became drudgery, and Sagani experienced her life back in Masuk as if in someone else's skin. So she fought to feel the worth of her actions, or, at least, to let her village feel them. She led ever longer and more ambitious hunts, mentoring the younger rangers who followed her. On one such expedition, her party was beset by a blizzard, and she pressed on where her companions turned back. She did not return to Masuk. For you, the death of Theos brought an end to your waking visions, and a silence to the whispers of the past. In their absence, you were able to sleep. The questions of a distant lifetime ceased to trouble your soul. All that remained was what to make of the answer. But at the moment, there was little to be done, and the matter would have to wait. A long journey loomed ahead.
And that is the end of Pillars of Eternity. So, we are going to watch the credits. This was an interesting game. It was pretty good. I liked it. It was a bit more difficult than I expected it to be. But only a little. There were only a few fights where it was really like, whoa. So, and I don't think that it was unfair in any places. I guess the dragon fight was a little unfair. But I had to basically split the enemy group in order to get a chance at that. But it was a good game, and I definitely enjoyed it. So we're just gonna chill here, listening to music and looking at the Audra columns, I guess. It's actually kind of interesting, because in these, I think voice actors show up toward the end. Which is interesting, because this is a distinction, because usually in movies, the actors themselves are first. Kuhat. So, unfortunately, I can see the cast, but I can't see who they played. I am going to take a look and see whether the character who played as Mitsuru was in this. Or the, sorry, not the person who played Mitsuru was in this one. And this is great. I finished the game, which means that I can now actually Google this game. I have not been able to do that at all. So, I'll be able to look up all sorts of interesting stuff that I haven't been able to look up yet that I've been thinking about for the last, like, month that I've been playing this. I think it has been about a month. It's gonna be a lot more than a month for you guys. I like that the epilogue touched on the Cad Nua place, and that killing the master below had an influence on the epilogue. Kickstarter gold level backends. Brandon I Am Tall Jackson. Justin Raphael the Sorcerer Trapani? That's a very strange name. Not more so than Nathan Diseased Yak Gilman. That's... Sharp. Stream Boy Advance. I do think that letting the credits roll out is somewhat important. Of course, for people that are watching this on YouTube, they probably just skip past this part. It occurs to me this isn't doing it on a stream anymore. But, yeah, so the next game that I'm going to be doing is probably going to be Kingdom Hearts, because it has been requested of me that I do Kingdom Hearts next. But I'm might do something else. I'm also thinking about doing I'm thinking about redoing the Persona 3 run that I started on my stream. That was the
round one maxing all social links run, so I'm considering doing that as well. But we'll see whether I get around to that. I might want to do that slightly closer to when Persona 5 is going to come out. Or I might want to do it further away from Persona 5 coming out, because then I'll have plenty of time to get into the mood to do it. That is a lot of people. So this is basically every single person that gave them money on Kickstarter. And this was a very interesting game. One of the things that I think worked very well here is that they really did do things that I don't think you normally would touch on or do in a video game. A lot of the writing felt more mature than you get in most video games. So I think that they did do a good job with that. And I think that a large portion of that is that rather than having a traditional publisher, they did a Kickstarter. And that gives them the ability to just handle things how they want. Now, I don't think that Kickstarter people are really that important. It's not like these are actual developers. These are just people that gave them money. I don't need to pay attention to every single person that gave them money. This is really disorienting to look at. So let's just pop this to 32. And somehow it's going faster, but it's actually less disorienting to look at. So, who's this? This is more Kickstarters? There we go. So, looks like we're at the end. Okay, so there we go. We've reached the end. So that's going to be it for today. Thank you everyone for watching. It has been a pleasure to stream for you guys again today. And I'll see you next time with a different game.